as you're saying, you always had the legal authority to stop deportations. Then why did you deport 2 million people?
Jorge, we're not going to.
For 6 years, you did it. You listen, destroyed Jorge, many families. Jorge, they called you deporter in chief.
You called me deporter in chief.
I did not. From La Raza.
But let me say this, Jorge.
But you could have stopped deportation.
No. That's the whole idea. That is not true. Listen, here's the fact of the matter.
You could have stopped them.
Jorge, here's the fact of the matter. Mm-hmm. As president of the United States, I'm always responsible for problems that aren't solved right away. I regret millions of people who didn't get health insurance before I passed health insurance and before I implemented it. I regret the fact that there are kids who should have been going to college during my presidency, but because we didn't get to them fast enough, they gave up on college. The question is, are we doing the right thing, and have we consistently tried to move this country in a better direction? And those like you sometimes, Jorge, who suggest that there are simple, quick answers to these problems.
I think, yes, you do,
because that's how you present it. And I think when you present it in that way, it does a disservice, because it makes the assumption that the political process is one that can easily be moved around depending on the will of one person. And that's not how things work. We spent that entire time trying to get a comprehensive immigration reform bill done that would solve the problem for all the people. So right now, by the actions that I've taken, I still have 5 million people who do not have the ability to get registered and be confident that they're not deported. In fact, what's going to happen sometime over the next 2 days, week, month, is that there are going to be some folks who are still caught up in the system because we have to go and train ICE workers so that they are responding in a different way. And so the question I have for you, Jorge, because you're going to have a big voice, is are you going to do a good job in, now that we've taken these actions, making sure that people understand what their opportunities are, how we can take advantage of it, and how we can build to make sure that going forward, not only as many people register as possible, if you've been here for 5 years, if you have a child who's an American citizen or a legal permanent resident, that you are likely to end up signing up.
And we'll report about
that. So that we build up that capacity and we lay the groundwork for passing comprehensive immigration reform. Because if we don't do that, then it is true that there are going to be a whole bunch of folks who try to push back. And this is necessarily a temporary measure designed to help as many people as we can right now. But we've still got a big fight that we're going to have to take in the future.
I could continue on immigration.
I'd be happy to do it. But you're probably running out of time.
On Cuba, it's the 5th anniversary of the arrest of Alan Gross in Cuba. Are you making efforts for his release? Is there going to be a prisoner swap with the 3 Cuban spies being held in Miami?
You know, we've been in conversations about how we can get Alan Gross home for quite some time.
With the Cuban government?
We have been working through a whole variety of channels. We continue to be concerned about him. We think that he shouldn't have been held in the first place. With respect to Cuba generally, I've made very clear that the policies that we have in making remittances easier for Cuban families and making it easier for families to travel have been helpful to people inside of Cuba, but the Cuban government still needs to make significant changes. Beyond that, I don't have any announcements.
All right. Bill Cosby has been lately in the news because of rape accusations. What's the best way to deal with something like this right now?
I think that it's important to not focus on one case, but to focus on the broader concerns that I have about how women and sometimes men are subjected to sexual assaults. And that's been true in our military, that's true in our colleges and universities. We're focused at the White House on making sure that we're raising awareness. Part of it is passing laws, but part of it is also changing minds and culture, not only to make it safe for those who've been assaulted to come forward, but also to change the mindset of men, particularly our young men who are coming up, so that they understand that no means no, that respect for women and individuals is what makes you strong. You know, that's an ongoing process, sort of like the process we talked about with respect to race. You know, politics can change policy, it can change laws, it can change law enforcement, and it then combines with changes in culture and perceptions, and over time, we make progress. You know, Dr. King said once that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And you know, I'm a big believer in the notion that even though sometimes history moves backwards, sometimes it moves sideways, that if people of goodwill keep pushing, eventually we have a more just society. And that's you know, hopefully part of my role as President of the United States, and that'll be part of your role as a journalist.
I hope so.
Okay.
So, thanks so much.
Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
How's your health?
Appreciate it. My health is fine.
Yes.
That was nothing.
Nothing? That's good.